afternoon, everyone. My name is Aubrie Jacobson, and I'm a piano performance major here at Viterbo University. Today, I'd like to share with you the research I did last summer on the Kalevala, which is the national epic of Finland. I'll discuss the political background of Finland and its history, the national epic called Kalevala, music, art, and literature inspired by this epic, and experiences I had this summer and throughout my life exploring the unique Finnish culture. My goal is to explain how the national epic of Finland has influenced the culture of a country that is very important to me, and how this in turn spurred on the nationalist movement in Finland that led to its independence from Russia in the year 1917. There are several reasons that I wish to look into this topic. First of all, I wanted to educate people about a culture that I find to be underappreciated in the United States. I also wanted to learn about my own heritage, as I'm about 50% Finnish, and have been surrounded by the Finnish culture my entire life, growing up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. I also wanted to discover and highlight artistic aspects of Finland, a country that's not necessarily well known for art and music, but has produced many notable works. There are several ways that I carried out this research this past summer. First of all, I did a literary review. I read many books and scholarly articles that I found in my hometown of Marquette, Michigan, in the Copper Country in Michigan, and here in La Crosse and online. I also visited several museums in the UP and in Finland when I took a trip there last summer. I went to the National Museum of Finland, Ainola, Sibelius' home, the Ateneum, which is an art museum, the Axeli Gullin Kalevala Museum, the Sibelius Museum, and I also visited the Finnish American Heritage Center in Calumet, Michigan, which has a large archive of Finnish American literature. I also interviewed two knowledgeable Finnish Americans, Tanya Paskas-Stanoin and Craig Randall Johnson, both of whom are very involved with the Finnish culture and furthering of Finnish music in the United States. I attended FinFest USA in Tampere, Finland this past summer. And I also just spent time in Finland. I met some of my family members, and I was able to absorb the language, culture, and music through them. Author Glenda Don Goss mentions four notable pillars of Finnish identity in her book, Sibelius. These pillars will appear throughout the rest of my presentation and are as follows. The first is Lutheranism. Religion is an important aspect of Finnish culture. Another important aspect is the literary tradition in Finland, including books written both in Swedish and Finnish, and also including the Bible. Another aspect of Finnish culture that's very important is the Kalevala, which was the centerpiece of my research this summer. As I mentioned, the Kalevala is the national epic of Finland, and it greatly influenced many Finnish artists and nationalists in the early 19th and 20th centuries. The Kalevala was the first major piece of Finnish literature that was actually written in the Finnish language. The fourth pillar of identity in the Finnish culture is the Finnish language, and I will now explain several aspects of the Finnish language that make it unique. As I said, the Finnish language is extremely unique. This is why it's such an important aspect of Finnish culture. It's only similar to one other modern language, which is Estonian. At the beginning of the Reformation era, Finnish was the conversational language of both upper and lower class citizens, but Finns began to abandon the Finnish language in favor of Swedish to promote social mobility when Finland was under Swedish control. Finland existed under Swedish rule for over 600 years. There was a centralized government based in Stockholm, and all affairs of business and what have you were carried out in the Swedish language. The Finnish language essentially died out. Literature was written almost exclusively in Swedish, and Swedish culture reigned supreme for 600 years. Because of this, Swedish rule greatly stunted the growth of Finnish culture. Finland came under Russian rule in the year 1809. At first, Finland prospered both culturally and economically under the Emperor Alexander II. But as Alexander III took over, there were some concerns about Russification in the country of Finland, so tensions began to build, and over the next several decades until the Finnish Civil War led to a victory for the Finnish whites and the new nation of Finland in December 1917. I will now explain several important aspects relating to the Kalevala, one of the important pillars of Finnish identity. The Kalevala was compiled by Dr. Elias Lönnrot and published in its final form in 1849. Dr. Lönnrot studied humanistic studies at the University of Turku at a time when romantic nationalism was really building and national folk poetry was receiving a lot of attention on the world stage. The national romantic movement increased interest in the ancient past of a nation and the impulse to develop underdeveloped cultures such as that of Finland at the time. The justification for the independence of a nation was often sought in the nation's history. This is why a document such as the Kalevala became so important for the furthering of Finnish culture and also the independence of the country. Dr. Lönnrot and other collectors obtained thousands of lines of poetry from rune singers in the Karelian region of Finland. And the Kalevala is made up of 22,000 of those lines of rune song. Rune song is a specific type of oral tradition that exists in the Karelian region of Finland. Some specific characteristics of rune song include a specific musical meter, which is usually 4-4 or 5-4 time, and a specific rhythm that goes along with those meters. Also, rune song is simple in construction, narrow in range, and has alliterative line endings, and is performed with a sort of call and response ritual, and often performed with a kantele, like the one I have. Rune song is the largest component that makes up the Kalevala. Poems from the early Kalevala period come from the Proto-Finnic era, or the beginning of the Common Era. These runes are typically shamanic poems, ritual or wedding songs, and songs that discuss the formation or creation of the universe or basic elements such as earth, wind, and fire. The Middle Kalevala period is the time period from about the 9th to the 12th centuries, in which Viking raids and crusades were taking place in Finland. And finally, the medieval Kalevala period often incorporates Christian themes. As I mentioned before, rune song originates in the Karelian region. Finnish Karelia is a historical province of Finland, which Finland was forced to partially cede to Russia in 1940 after the Russo-Finnish War. The division of Karelia in 1940 was extremely destructive to the rune singing tradition in the part of Finland where it flourished the most. This destruction emphasizes, again, the need for a document such as the Kalevala to keep the culture going of a region that was being Russified and taken away from the Finnish people. Here's a brief overview of the Kalevala. It begins with a creation myth, and then it goes into a bunch of storylines, including many different characters. And you can see at the top here, here's a depiction of some of the storylines and some of the characters in the Kalevala. Finally, the Kalevala ends with the arrival of Christianity in Finland, which was a conscious decision by Lönnrot, because at that time, Christianity was a way of elevating a culture. Themes in the Kalevala include music, wisdom, knowledge, and nature. For example, the Kalevala discusses the birth of the kantele, or lap harp, which is made out of the jawbone of a fish. Wainamoinen, a major character in the Kalevala, is a wise old man. Vakavana Wainamoinen actually means wise old Wainamoinen in Finnish. Knowledge and skill are also valued in the Kalevala and in Finnish society today. Finland's education system is one of the strongest in the world. Nature is also a major theme throughout the Kalevala and is also highly valued in Finnish culture today. Bears and swans frequently appear throughout the epic, and they have different symbolic meanings. Next, I'll talk about music that was inspired by the Kalevala. There are approximately 350 compositions based on Kalevalaic themes. John Sibelius is one of Finland's most notable composers, and he first realized he wanted to explore the Kalevala when he was a student in Vienna. John Sibelius had a very large lasting effect on the musical world of Finland, and many of his pieces had Kalevalaic themes. I'd like to highlight just one work by Sibelius that includes these themes. The Lemminkainen Suite, which is a four-movement orchestral suite. As you can imagine, as I said, over 350 compositions were based on the Kalevala, so here's just a few more. Just as the Kalevala influenced music, it also influenced literature, such as the poetry of the national poet of Finland, Eino Leino. Art was also inspired by the time, at this time by the Kalevala. The paintings of Aubrie Kalevala are notable works that are based on the Kalevala. Kalevala wished to bring the Kalevala to the common people, so he made depictions such as these for everybody to enjoy and see, even people who weren't able to read the Kalevala. And here's the ceiling of the National Museum of Finland. Each panel of this, you can't really see it right now, but they're really detailed murals of different stories in the Kalevala. Finally, I'd like to just touch on my firsthand experiences with the Finnish culture. I grew up, as I said, in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, a place where the Finnish culture is very strong and true. And there's a lot of people who are very proud of their Finnish heritage. So I've been witness to a lot of anecdotal evidence of both the solid and substantial nature of the unique Finnish identity, which is unique amongst all Nordic countries and across the world. This project's had many impacts on my daily life. I gave a recital just yesterday, a Finnish art song, with my fellow student Lydia Mackey. Many of the songs we performed emphasize the four pillars of Finnish identity. And this recital was a rewarding culmination of the work I did this summer. And my research greatly informed how I interpreted the music that Lydia and I did. I'd just like to leave you with this quote here by Kimmo Hakola. Thank you. I'll now take questions.
From the oral tradition of the rune music, from understanding this?
Yes, so Lönnrot went to Karelia and he listened to a lot of different rune singers. They perform their rituals, usually it's a call and response, oral tradition, and he recorded all of these. And then he brought them back and he worked them together into a storyline of his choice. So a lot of the poems are really, some of them are related, some of them are not related, but he worked it into a storyline using this oral tradition that he recorded in Karelia. Yes.
Have you shared your research with any, have you done any connections with people at other universities, like professors or other students who are interested in this topic?
Well, like I said, Lydia and I did that recital last night, so I think that was the biggest connection I've had with another student over our shared heritage. We're both Finnish, so that was a fun experience, just talking through music and how these pillars and how Finnish identity relates. We also just presented some of our songs at the WMTA, Wisconsin Music Teachers Association Conference, so I got to give a brief presentation about what we were doing, and then we also shared music.
One of your stated goals was to help people understand things that maybe are less appreciated, so I think you succeeded in that. This was really fascinating, stuff I didn't know about. And yet some of the themes I heard about were other cultures that also try to, it's not that they're inventing tradition, but really sort of consolidating tradition so that it can be clearer to the people, like when those, those cultures are under threat. And I'm just curious if you've come across other in other cultures around the world or similar things like this where they've tried to take these maybe sort of lost traditions and sort of consolidate them for a particular kind of mythos.
Sure, well, I'm not sure if I can think of a specific one, but I imagine whenever somebody is creating a national epic like this or compiling a big book of traditional oral tradition things, I imagine they have that in mind, just preserving that culture and trying to bring it to people. And art is a great way to do that because it's music and art are accessible to anybody. So I think a lot of these composers, a lot of nationalist composers and nationalist people who wrote books and whatnot, I think they probably have that in mind, but I can't think of a specific example.
So I'll ask a follow-up then, maybe with a little different edge to it, which is the way you presented it is very much a celebration of this kind of culture. And at the same time, I could imagine people taking this in a much darker way, right, where the nationalist culture and the mythos becomes something to push it back against other cultures, or and that. And just how your experience has been very positive. And so, just to talk maybe a little bit about what that has been like for you to kind of encounter, you know, the heritage that you have that's underappreciated, and how that's been a positive thing.
Yeah, it's been great. I really gained an appreciation for the music and culture. When I was growing up, I didn't always feel so strongly about Finland, but after visiting the country and meeting my family members, it really strengthened, you know, in me that I wanted to do this and I wanted to bring this culture to other people. But certainly I think there is a little bit of a darkness to it. I mean, in Finland trying to become this, they went through a lot of pain to get where they were. All these wars were very painful, and a lot of the music really reflects that. And I think also Finland's cultural identity, as I said, is kind of separate. They don't really consider themselves to be Scandinavian, so there is some heat between even like Sweden and Finland and Russia and Finland. But for me, it's been rewarding, and I've met people from all different backgrounds in Finland, people that have Swedish heritage and whatnot, and I think it's been positive overall.